going to the message. If you responded to the invitation, not this past Wednesday, but the first extra Wednesday, first extra conference service, to being a part of the 300, and we didn't get your name Friday night, then put that on a communication card so we know that you've responded to that, to be a part of that group. And also, and I was told, I think we need some more people to help with visiting people who come in for the first time. When people are here for the first time, we try to take a jar of honey by their house, a jar of honey grown by local bees. As to whether that's locally grown honey or whatever it is. Honey grown by local bees. We take a jar by their house to say if they're there, thanks for coming. And we know that connection means a lot to a lot of people. It's really one of the neat things to get to be a part of, because then you get to see people when they come back and make a connection with them. If you can help with that, I think most of those teams do it once a month, though some of our people get into, like all of our ministries, get into it and do it more often. But if you can help with that, they'd love to know about that. You can put that on a communication card. Not only is this Memorial Day weekend and Pentecost Sunday, it also is Aldersgate Sunday, which for all the people who come out of Wesleyan tradition from John Wesley, marks the time when John Wesley went to a prayer meeting on Aldersgate Street. He had, if some of you know a little bit about his story, the Anglican Church, Church of England, had really lost the concept that you could know you're saved. In fact, a lot of people thought it was very arrogant to say that you knew you were saved. And Wesley had gone as a missionary to Georgia in the early 1700s. On the way, his ship was in a storm, almost sank. They were afraid they would all die, and there were a group of Moravian Christians who were singing and were just totally at peace, and he knew they had something he didn't, and so he continued a relationship with them. When he got back to England, he became convinced that they were right. The scripture taught you could know you were saved, and he asked one of his friends, Peter Bowler, "Should I stop preaching?" He said, "No, preach it until you have it, and then preach it because you have it." And he says that in May, one night, he reluctantly went to a prayer meeting on Aldersgate Street. Someone was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle of Romans. Luther, of course, who came to that whole realization that you were saved by faith and not by our works. And he said, at about a quarter till nine, as someone was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle of Romans, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt that I trusted in God to forgive my sins, even mine. And that confirmation of salvation was something then that he had experienced. So this is a significant day in a lot of ways. And I think it's important that we observe some of these days like Memorial Day here in the church, because most of us don't get much opportunity outside of this to put some special focus and on a day like today to honor those who've laid down their lives for us. I want to ask you if you have a relative or a friend who's died in service to our country, would you stand? And we just want to take a moment to pray. Thank you. Let's pray together. Lord, we take this moment because we don't want to ever forget or take for granted the high price that people have paid for our freedom. Lord, we give thanks to you for the freedoms that we have enjoyed and Lord, relatively to other countries, what we still enjoy. And Lord, we know so much of that is because people have been willing and many have actually paid that price of laying down their life. And so, Lord, we honor them today and we give you thanks. And Lord, we just ask in every way that we would be people filled with courage. And as you've called us, people who are willing to lay down our life for the kingdom of God and for the salvation of other people. Thank you for the incredible blessings you've given us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. I want to read a couple of scripture passages to you as we get started today. Isaiah 66. In the beginning of that chapter, we read these words. This is what the Lord says. Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house you will build for me? Where will my resting place be? Has not my hand made all these things? And so they came into being, declares the Lord. These are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word. And then in James chapter 4, James writes this, "You adulterous people," very nice, you know, very seeker-friendly type statement there, right? "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he causes to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. That's why the Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he'll come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded." Then finally, in Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes this, "In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage." Oop, I think I've lost the rest of that. I'm sorry. Let me just go ahead and share. A lot of you are very familiar with that passage anyway, that goes on and says, even though he was in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage or grasp, but humbled himself and took on the very nature of a servant, becoming like, and he's called us to become like Christ. He humbled himself even to death on a cross. So sorry, I didn't give you all enough verses, guys. A servant. God opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. I want to ask you to just think with me for a moment. The name Whedon Kennedy, does any association come to your mind when you hear that name? Probably not. But what if you hear this phrase, "the man your man could smell like"? Anybody have an association with that? No? The man your man could smell like? Yeah, I heard somebody say it. Yeah, Old Spice, really great, mostly online advertising campaign. Whedon Kennedy is the company that put that advertising campaign together. What about DDB Chicago? That mean anything to anybody here? How about this phrase, "what's up"? Any association with that? Anybody remember what the product is? Budweiser, yeah, we don't endorse that here, but it was a good advertisement. How about BBDO? Anybody know anything about BBDO? How about this, "have it your way"? Yeah, there you go. Many years before that, they came out with another little phrase, "mm-mm good." All right, Campbell's soup. Advertising agencies don't exist to make a name for themselves, do they? They exist to make a name for somebody else. And that's what we exist for. We're created to bring glory to God. That's our purpose here. A few years ago, a book came out entitled Behavioral Genetics. It put together the finding of a group of scientists in exploring the human genome and the whole gene layout in the human body, concluded that every human being has the capability of producing 10 to the 3,000th power, 3,000 times multiplied, gene combinations, every human being. So then they said if a man can contribute 10 to the 3,000th power gene combinations, a woman the same number, then the likelihood of any two people, apart from twins, in the past or ever in the future, having the same gene makeup, the probability of that would be beyond any reasonable comprehension. The odds would be infinitesimally in the potential that could ever happen. In other words, when God made you, he broke the mold. You're one of a kind. Each one of us is. Each one of us created to be able to reflect the glory of God for all eternity in this life and in all eternity, like nobody else can reflect the glory of God. You know, before Copernicus in the 1500s, most people would look up at the stars and say, all these things are moving, but we don't move. Because everything moves around our planet. And then Copernicus started asking questions like, where'd the seasons come from? You know, why do we have seasons? And eventually ended up pointing up in the sun and said, no, that's the center of the solar system. And of course, we know the whole thing's moving at astronomical speeds. We're not the center. The earth is not the center. We're not the center. Now, it is interesting that it looks as if the whole universe is expanding. Well, we know the universe is expanding. And it looks as if it's all expanding from here. We do seem to be the center of the expansion of the universe. But the sun doesn't rotate around us. The other planets don't rotate around us. The world doesn't rotate around you or me. Right? Although, as a part of the sin nature, it kind of feels that way when we come into the world. I mean, you've heard me say before, if you look at life like a movie, you know, your eyes are the video, your ears, the audio, your memory, the hard drive. If you look at your life like a movie, you're the star, aren't you? I mean, you're the only one that's in every scene. You know, supporting actors come and go. They may play a bigger role or a small role, but you're the only one in every scene. And it's part of our sin nature to believe that life revolves around us. That we're the star. Of course, the problem is there's 7 billion other people, you know, who think they're starring in their own film as well. In reality, none of us was created to be the center. None of us was created to be the star. You know, the Ten Commandments, the very first one is, you shall have no other gods before me. The Hebrew people often refer to the Ten Commandments as the Ten Statements, saying more like, rather than this is a commandment for you to carry out, it is that, but more so it's just a statement of reality. These are statements of reality. This is how the world exists. You shall have no other gods before me. In other words, God is God. And you are not. And I am not. Turn to the person beside you, please, and say to them, there is a God and it's not you. Okay, that's enough. You don't have to tell them why you know it's not them. You can just tell them, it's good to always speak truth to one another, isn't it? In 1 Peter chapter 5, we read these words. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Isn't that interesting that in both 1 Peter and James, as soon as he talks about God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble, what does he start talking about? He starts talking about our enemy, the enemy of our soul. Be on your guard. Your enemy, the devil, is like a roaring lion seeking who he may devour. In James, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. You know, pride is really like the primary opposition against God. You know, pride is a me-first focus of life. It really is the result of the fall. You know, Satan's rebellion against God involved pride. I'll ascend to the throne of the Most High and I will be like God. The temptation he gave to Adam and Eve, you won't die if you eat the fruit, but you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And that's at the root. It is not seeing reality. It's either thinking more or less than ourselves than we really are, but at the core of pride is a me-first attitude of life where everything rotates around me and God opposes the proud. And it's the main issue, more than anything else, in following Christ or not? Am I going to be God of my own life? Or is God going to be God of my own life? You know, pride is one of those things, C.S. Lewis says, that we don't see in ourselves, but we hate in other people, don't we? Saw a little cartoon a few years ago. It was a dog and cat looking out a window, and the dog is saying to the cat, they don't put a leash on you because they want you to run away. Yeah, it's that kind of thing of somebody has something you don't have, you just kind of want to bring them down a little bit. And see, the pride in us, when we see pride in somebody else, that's how we respond. You know, it's that whole idea of trying to bring them down a little bit. Pride. 2 Kings chapter 5, we read about a general in the nation of Aram, or Syria, named Naaman. And Naaman is one of the most powerful people in his country. He's had all kind of success in battle. He has wealth. He has great influence. But then in chapter 5, he also has leprosy. You know, all of a sudden, there's a major problem in his life that he can't control. He has a servant. Well, his wife has a servant girl who was taken from Israel. And she says to Naaman's wife, if only he could go and see the prophet Elisha, who is in Israel, then he could be healed. Well, she says that to Naaman. Naaman goes to the king, and the king says, certainly, go and see the king of Israel. I'll write a note for you. I'll write a letter. And so he writes this letter commending his general Naaman, sending him to the king of Israel so that he might be healed. Well, the king of Israel tears his robes and says, who am I? Am I God that I can heal this man of leprosy? What does he mean in asking me to heal his general? See what he's trying to do? He's just trying to pick a fight with me. He's wanting an excuse to go to battle. When Elisha hears about it, he contacts the king and says, send him to me, so the general will know that there's a prophet in Israel. And so Naaman goes with his entourage and all kinds of wealth to give to the prophet. They travel from Syria to Israel. They come to the town where Elisha was. I don't know if Elisha was still in Dothan. The next chapter, he's in Dothan. But he comes and, you know, parks his motorcade outside of Elisha's house or tent or whatever it was. And Elisha doesn't even bother to come out of the house. He sends his servant to tell Naaman, go and dip yourself 7 times in the river. Now, you know, this is a humbling thing for a powerful, influential, wealthy person, maybe second to the king of Syria. And here he's traveled, he's humbled himself to come to this prophet of another god that he doesn't even worship in this kind of second-rate country compared to Syria. And he travels all this way, and the prophet doesn't even come out to speak to him. He even says that. He says, I thought at least he'd come out and stand before me and call on the name of his Lord and wave his hand over my body and heal me. And it says he's furious, and he starts to leave, and his servants are all trying to decide, okay, who's gonna say something to him about this? You know, let's draw straws. Short straw has to talk to the general. And one of the servants, or maybe a couple of them, say, listen, if he had asked you to do something really difficult, you would have done it. Now all he's asking you to do is go wash in this river. And so Naaman goes, and the 7th time he comes out of the water, the leprosy is gone. Just think, his pride almost cost him being whole. Fortunately, he had servants that cared about him and spoke and reasoned with him. And of course, Naaman says to Elijah, can I give you all this wealth? Elijah says, I don't need it. You know, take it back with you. Well, can I at least take as much dirt as 2 donkeys can carry? Because from now on, I want to worship the God of Israel. And I'll take this soil as a place where I can stand, where I can kneel and worship the God of Israel. Wonder what else it might have cost him. May have cost him eternal life if he had had too much pride. It's amazing how much fear we live with when we hold on to our pride. It was that fear of losing status, losing our position, losing respect. Because our pride, see, our pride values our position, our accomplishments, our reputation more than anything else. And so we live with that fear. A lot of times we live with a fear of repeating the past. You know, so often when we've experienced shame or abuse growing up, we vow that we will never be disrespected like that again. You know, vows are dangerous things. We bind ourselves by vows. You know, even the Bible says we ought to even be very careful about the vows we make to God. That's good to make vows to God, but the Bible cautions us, be careful. You know, be sure you're ready to fulfill those vows when you make them. And a lot of times we're held captive by the vow, I will never let that happen to me again. So we hang on to our pride. We live with the fear that one day we might not measure up. Pride does terrible things to us. A lot of you know that old story about the CEO of the Fortune 500 company who is out for the weekend out of the city with his wife. They stop at a little gas station as they're headed out up to the mountains. And his wife, who goes in to buy a bottle of water, ends up in this fairly animated, intense conversation with the attendant there. In fact, after he fills up the gas tank, he waits for a few minutes, has to go in to get his wife, and they get back in the car, and he says, you know that man? She says, yeah, I went to high school with him. In fact, we used to date in high school. And they pull out, and after a few seconds, this CEO has kind of a smug look on his face, and he says, I bet I know what you're thinking. She says, what? He says, I bet you're thinking how grateful you are that you married me and you're the wife of a CEO, instead of marrying him and the wife of a gas station attendant. She says, well, no, actually, I was thinking if I had married him, he'd be the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, and you'd be. Listen, you know, pride separates us from God. In fact, God opposes the proud. You ever had somebody in authority oppose you? Teacher? That's bad to have a teacher that doesn't like you. It's a whole lot worse to have the opposition of God. God opposes the proud. He gives grace to the humble. Pride ruins relationships. I mean, how many of you just love to be close to a prideful person? How many of you, your dream was just to end up with somebody filled with pride? Nobody wants that. 1 Corinthians 13, love chapter, says, love is patient, love is kind, does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. Love does not boast, it is not proud. See, pride creates a barrier between us and other people. Because there's always competition and pride, we've got to come out on top. There's no love in pride. Love doesn't boast, isn't proud, doesn't dishonor others, is not self-seeking. Can we really be free? Can we really be free of orienting life around our own interests? The Holy Spirit can set us free from that. Love is not self-seeking, easily angered, keeps no record of wrong, does not delight in evil, rejoices with the truth, always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Pride is enmity. Because of the competition, because of having to come out on top, it creates enmity. We find ourselves in opposition to other people. Ironically, it kills contentment and joy. It causes us to view life as unfair. It makes us ungrateful because we deserve everything that comes our way good anyway. And the things that don't come our way that we expect, Well, that's really unfair. We end up in competition even with God. Because at its heart, pride is, I will be the God of my own life, thank you. It's my life, nobody else's. It's my body, it's my time, it's my money, it's my decision. Even though none of us gave ourselves life, none of us is giving ourselves our own heartbeats or breath right now, are we? Even though the Word says it's God who gave us the ability to make money, we say it's ours. Whether I ever say it consciously or not, I live as if my life is my own. I'm the God of my own life. You remember the little story of Jonah? You know, Jonah who was swallowed by the whale. If you hadn't read that story lately, read it this afternoon. It's only 2 pages. You know, he is called to go to Nineveh. Nineveh was the capital of the Assyrian Empire, the big enemy to Israel that would eventually take the northern kingdom of Israel into captivity. They were probably the most brutal of all the ancient empires. They were bad to the people they conquered. And here Jonah is being called by God to go and preach in their capital, Nineveh. And so he goes the other way. And you know the story. I mean, the ship ends up in a big storm. The people there who are all trying to decide, you know, who's offended their God. You know, the Lord actually works through that and directs them to Jonah, who says, yeah, throw me overboard. They try not to. They try to battle the storm more. Finally, they do. It says the Lord's prepared a great fish. And the fish saves his life, really. But for 3 days, he's in the fish before it throws him up on the shore near Nineveh. Second chance. He goes to Nineveh. Marches around and tells them that in 40 days, God is going to destroy the city. Remember what happens? The king gets word and he calls on all the people to dress in sackcloth and ashes. Outward means of repentance, sign of repentance, and to repent. And even their animals, he says, even the animals should not eat anything. They should all fast and be in sackcloth and ashes. Don't quite know what that looked like. And maybe this God will hear and relent. And he does. Because of their repentance, he spares the city. And Jonah, man, you know how happy he had to have been. He's not happy at all. He's mad. He's angry. I mean, this is our enemy. And here I told everybody what was going to happen. And now you're going to spare them. In fact, he says, I knew this would happen. You're so gracious and compassionate, you know. He's mad. And the Lord says, do you have a right to be mad? Jonah doesn't save him. Basically, he says, yeah, I sure do. And so he goes up on this hill to watch what may happen, hoping maybe that his anger will change God's mind. Long story short, the Lord says, you know, well, the Lord actually calls this vine to grow up so he can sit in his shade. And the next day, he says, the Lord also provided a worm. That's an interesting thing, isn't it? He had a purpose for that worm. Go and destroy that vine. And then Jonah got mad again. He says, you're all concerned with this vine. Shouldn't I be concerned with this city of 125,000 people and much cattle? You know? Has an interesting phrase too, and much cattle. The cattle, the livestock were in sackcloth and ashes, and the Lord at the end recognizes the cattle again. Listen, Jonah preached, and his sermon was one of the most effective sermons in history. You know, when you can preach the cows to come home, you're preaching a good sermon. But he couldn't enjoy the sermon. He was too angry because he had his own agenda. His agenda was more important to him than God's agenda. Some of you heard this before. Beth Moore wrote this little thing entitled, I Am Pride. It's got some really good insight, I think. It says, my name is Pride, and I am a cheater. I cheat you out of your God-given destiny because you demand your own way. I cheat you out of contentment because you deserve better than this. I cheat you out of forgiveness because you're too full of me to forgive. I cheat you out of holiness because you refuse to admit when you're wrong. I cheat you out of vision because you'd rather look in the mirror than out the window. I cheat you out of genuine friendship because nobody's ever going to know the real you. I teach you out of love, because real love demands sacrifice. I teach you out of greatness in heaven, because you refuse to wash another's feet on earth. I teach you out of God's glory, because I convince you to seek your own. My name is pride, and I'm a cheater. You like me because you think I'm always looking out for you. Untrue. I'm looking to make a fool out of you. God has so much for you, I admit, but don't worry. If you stick with me, you'll never know. Pride. God gives grace to the humble. What does it mean to be humble? To be humble means to see ourselves as we really are. We see ourselves as God sees us. We come to the realization and accept the truth that in my flesh there is no good thing, and apart from him I can do nothing. But I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And in him I'm the righteousness of God. He's called me because of who he is. To be his son, to be his daughter, to be his disciple, to be his ambassador, his representative, to be heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. See, we're like everything else in creation. We have our value in him. And he's the one we're made for. And apart from him, there's no life. Apart from him, there's only death. Being humble is seeing ourselves as God sees us. We don't always have that perspective, God's perspective, do we? I remember a number of years ago, John Weiss, who pastors in Lexington, Kentucky, was telling about being out on one of the main roads there, Nicholasville Road. And Lexington is a university town. University of Kentucky's there. And you know, I mean, in a university town, you can see anything, you know? I mean, anything can happen. And so here he was with his family one evening on Nicholasville Road. It was a convertible in front of him. And all of a sudden, this woman sits up on the back of the convertible, totally naked. Nothing on at all. And they're stuck in traffic behind. I mean, there's, you know, he can't, there's a lot of cars, it's busy, they're not stopped, but there's a lot of traffic. His five-year-old son, Silas, is in the van. And Silas sees this woman, and he says, "Dad, that woman is not wearing a seatbelt." It's a different perspective, right? Five-year-olds don't always have the same perspective that we have. We don't have the same perspective God has until we humble ourselves before him. When we humble ourselves, we see ourselves as he sees us, and he promises us grace. The word says, when we humble ourselves, we will be exalted. Those who are servants, the word says, Jesus said, are the greatest in the kingdom of God. It's amazing the freedom and confidence that comes when we can humble ourselves. I always think about that account of Jesus washing his disciples' feet, and I think it's John 13. And, you know, it begins that section with saying, Jesus, knowing who he was, that all things had been placed under his feet, where he had come from and where he was going, then showed the disciples the full extent of his love. Takes out his outer garment as the water and begins to wash his disciples' feet. I just love that, knowing who he was. Knowing that everything had been put under his feet. Where he had come from, where he was going. It was a confidence when we see ourselves as we really are. You know, we don't have to prop ourselves up. When he's God, our reputation's in his hands. He can do with it what he wants. I mean, we're his. We're for the praise of his glory. We don't have to constantly worry about our glory. The confidence, freedom, wisdom. You know, wisdom is seeing life as it really is. It's an understanding how to live life. Until our eyes are open to who we really are and God really is, there's no wisdom. It opens the door to real love. We become like Christ. God uses us when we humble. Somebody get that? And if it's for me, tell him I can't talk right now, but I'll be glad to call him back after the service. He uses us when we humble ourselves before him. Doug Sethman worked in China for a number of years and worked with the house church movement, underground churches. And I wrote about 12 years ago about some of his experiences. And he just said, you know, he met a number of just amazing Christians. But he talked about one man in several meetings he was in that just stood out to him. This man had been imprisoned and tortured for decades. And he said his body was bent. He had experienced malnutrition and had bones broken and the torture that he went through. But he said he had this amazing smile. He just beamed, just glowed all the time. He said it was like the glory of God just emanated from him. And so finally one evening he just asked him, "Why are you so happy? Especially after all the terrifying experiences that you've had." This man said to him, "God put me in school there. He showed me I needed to learn many important lessons. Only then did it become possible for me to live in such an impossible situation. I never would have chosen this route, but this is the way that God led." He said, "I learned to give up my rights." Doug said, "I started thinking about how much fighting and protesting for rights that we've had over the years in our country." He said, "I gave up my rights." The Bible, he says, doesn't guarantee that we'll always live in freedom. So I gave up my right to freedom. The Bible doesn't always say that we'll get to live with our family. So I gave up my right to my family. I gave up the right to earn my way, to accumulate wealth. In fact, he said, the only right that I could find in the Bible was my right to be a child of God. And that one I did not give up. When you've died to yourself, he said, you discover a freedom that no man can touch. And Seth said, that's why his face radiated. A freedom that only comes in Christ, that no government, army, or prison can ever take away. When we humble ourselves before God, we're exalted by Him. This past fall, our staff had a retreat for a couple of days, and we were at Bay Point at Panama City. And one evening, we went out to watch sunset. And, you know, Bay Point is kind of at the Grand Lagoon to the south of it and the main part of the bay to the east of it. And so there's a little beach out there that got on a peninsula. And so we went out there. They have all these beach chairs out there, just to watch the sunset. And we're all watching. And, you know, as I said, Grand Lagoon's in front of us and going off to the west, and just to the southeast is the entrance into the bay, and all down the side to our east is the main part of the bay. And, you know, we were watching it and talking, and it was a nice sunset. It was nothing spectacular, you know. There wasn't a lot of cloud to reflect the colors, but it was nice. But after a few minutes, I turned around, and behind us, coming up over the bay, was a full moon. And it was just above the horizon, so it was huge. And the light was reflecting across the water. And there were all these palm trees they had planted there, and so it was between these palm trees. And, you know, when everybody saw it, we started, you know, framing it in the trees and taking prom pictures. It looked like, you know, looked like a backdrop for a prom or something. I mean, it was beautiful, it was spectacular. You know, the sunset was okay. The moon was spectacular. You know, it's really interesting how often the moon is a source of inspiration, romance, beauty. Just about any night I go out, I look up to see what the moon looks like. People have been on the moon before. We know the moon doesn't have any light of its own, does it? And apart from reflecting the sun, it just seems to be a cold, dead, big rock. I mean, maybe it didn't get the glory of the sun. The Bible calls it the lesser sun. You know, we consider sunning legitimate, mooning, maybe not. The butt of many bad jokes, right? You know what the moon's glory is? The moon's glory is reflecting the sun. That's why it took our breath away that night. That's why it's such a source of beauty and inspiration. Its glory is that it reflects the light of the sun. Interesting, in this conference, we've used as a theme verse 2 Corinthians 3:16 through 18 that just says this: whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Now some translations say, behold His glory. Other translations say, reflect His glory. Because the Greek word there is katapriso, and it can mean both or either. Contemplate, to behold, or to reflect. You know, in the context of the story, he's talking about the veil being taken away. He's talking about Moses, when Moses was on the mountain with God. And when he came down, the glory from the presence of God was on him so much that his face, it said, was too bright for the people to look at. So for a period of time, he covered it with a veil. And so Moses beheld the glory of God, and then he reflected the glory of God. And that's what he calls us to do. We all who with unveiled faces katapriso, the glory of the Lord. Behold and reflect the glory of the Lord. See, our glory is to bring glory to the God of the universe. That's our glory. That's our purpose. Apart from it, kind of like the moon, cold, dead rock. But when we behold Him, reflect Him, it's our glory. You know, the beginning point of all that is repentance. And that's one of the main things that's been happening in this extended conference has been repentance. It always is when God really begins to move in power. I mean, there's that first repentance. It's the only way to get to God. You know, repentance is not a popular word, but what a fantastic word. I mean, in Scripture we read that John the Baptist, who came preparing the way of the Lord, came preaching repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And then Jesus, we read, came preaching repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Why? Because in repentance we can humble ourselves. We can allow God to show us who we really are, what our destiny really is. We can be transformed. We can be set free, all in humbling ourselves to repent before God. And of course, it's not just that one time. I mean, a life in the Spirit is a life where we continue in repentance. Psalms 139, David writes, "Search me, O God, and show me my heart." During this conference, we've repented of things that we didn't even know we needed to repent of. You see, that's one of the great things when God is moving. He does a deeper cleansing in us so we can see Him better. And so we can reflect Him better. Because we humble ourselves. We agree with the truth that we need Him and He's the only one that can make us what we were really created to be. And we lay down our lives and lay down our sin. We turn away and the door is open then for forgiveness, for cleansing, for peace, for joy, for real love, for transformation in our lives, that we could begin to be the people God created us to be, for freedom, for purpose, for life that is really life, to become our life. That's what he wants to do in us. That we let go of our pride, humble ourselves, and repent. And then we get him. And he gets us. And the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord is poured out on us, his people. And we're transformed from glory to glory. Transformed with ever-increasing glory that comes from him. That is our purpose, our destiny. And that's what he's calling us to. Just stand with me, please. Just bow your head for a moment. The altar here is a great place to pray. If God is drawing you toward repentance, toward humbling yourself, a great way to humble ourselves is to kneel. And so if he's speaking to you, you come on while I'm talking. Altar team is going to be here. They'd love to pray with you. Now is the time to step out of the deception of pride and into the reality of who we are in Christ. It's a whole lot better than what we've projected for ourselves. It is life. Our life is to bring glory to him. And in that glory, we receive the purpose God created us for. You know, God's not going to just say to us one day, "Oh, I know it was hard. It's all right that you lived in pride." No, when we choose sin, when we choose pride, we choose against God. And if we persist, it destroys the image of God in us. And there's no life apart from him. The last chapter of the Bible, there's a passage, Revelation 22:11, that says, "Let him who does wrong continue to do wrong. Let him who is vile continue to be vile. Let him who does right continue to do right. Let him who is holy continue to be holy." There will be a day when we are set as we are forever. But now is the time of God's grace. And now is the time he's leading us into freedom, into our purpose, into our true identity, into measureless love and joy and victory, to know him, to behold his glory, and to be transformed from with ever-increasing glory as we reflect the glory of the Lord. You know, in these extended conferences, services, there's been a lot of repentance of sin, repentance of apathy, repentance of areas of being lukewarm that we didn't even see before, repentance of giving too much attention to other things. And when we do it, it's like the love of God, the passion for him is just magnified. And we're amazed at who he is. That's his call to you. His call to me. Lord, I just pray that none of us would grasp our own pride. Regardless of our past, vows of the past we choose to break, or that we would not live in that delusion that says, "My life is my own, and I'll do with it as I please." Lord, open our eyes to truth, to reality, to what you've called us to the victory that you want us to know in you. That we would see you, behold your glory, and that we would know our glory of reflecting the wonder and majesty and beauty, holiness, righteousness, wisdom, goodness, the one who's created us and called us. Continue this work you're doing in us. Thank you. How wonderful it is to be in your hands. How wonderful it is to be available for your work and transformation in us. Thank you for what you're going to do in these coming days as we continue to follow you. We give you all the praise and glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you.